So on this day, I am in need for some more sandwich bread in the house. So I am putting together the ingredients for that, and I'm doing 2 teaspoons of the active dry yeast, and then I'm going to be doing a tablespoon-ish of honey. I don't really measure out the honey too well. We do like a sweeter kind of butter honey type bread, so I do kind of go heavy on the honey. And then it is a tablespoon to 2 tablespoons of butter, whichever you would like. The fat in the butter does help keep the bread from being real crumbly. So, I mean, and if you don't want to use butter, you can use whatever oil you would like to put in there. And so while I was putting those in the bowl, I did have some water warming up on top of the stove. And so some warm water, you want it between 90 and 100 degrees. So not too hot, because you don't want to kill your yeast. And then you add 1 1/3 cup of the water, get all that mixed well to get that yeast nice and activated. And then I added I did half einkorn flour and half of the all-purpose flour. So the einkorn flour, I had 242 grams of fat. And then with the all-purpose flour, I stopped at 251 grams. So it's not perfect 50-50. But that's what I did on this day. On other days, sometimes it's a little different. It really just kind of depends on the day and how it worked out. So then I added between 6 and 7 grams of salt, and then 1 egg. It can be out of the fridge, room temperature, whatever you like. So then I just attached this to my KitchenAid with the dough hook to let it mix up really well. I am looking for a nice, smooth, silky texture with my dough for it to know that that's when it's ready. If you don't have a stand mixer to do this with, you can do it by hand. I mean, any kind of bread you can 100% make by hand. It just takes a little more time, and I like to be able to just have my stand mixer doing it for me while I do other things. But it actually is very therapeutic making bread by hand. And so if you want to do that, or you don't really have a choice but to do that, it is possible. It's perfectly fine. So I did add a little bit of flour because it was sticking to the bottom a little too much after mixing for about, I say it was probably about 10 to 15 minutes. And so now it's made a nice ball on the hook here. You can see it's not sticking to my fingers really bad, and it's coming off the hook real nice and clean. And so that's really good. The texture is soft, it's silky, there's no lumps, there's no dry spots. It's not sticking to my fingers bad, it's not sticking to the bowl bad, not sticking to the hook bad. I'm able to stretch it here pretty good. And so that tells me it is moist, but that's okay. That tells me that that dough is ready. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to cover that, and I'm going to set it to the side on top of the counter and let it double in size for about an hour. That's what it takes in my kitchen on this day. So while that is rising, I am going to go ahead and get the cookies put together. And so I'm doing 1 1/2 cups of oats. And then I'm using 1 1/2 cups of all-purpose flour. You can use oat flour if you need it to be gluten-free. If you don't have oat flour but you have the oats, then you just put oats in a food processor or even a blender and just blend it up until it makes flour. It's really that simple. You don't have to buy it separate. You can just buy like a lot of oats, and then if you need oat flour for whatever reason, you blend those up and you have perfectly fine oat flour. Then I added 1 teaspoon of cinnamon, 1/2 teaspoon of baking powder, 1/2 teaspoon of baking soda, 1/4 teaspoon of salt. I did 1/4 because I use salted butter, which I have melting in the oven while I'm mixing this up. But if you're using unsalted butter, you might want to consider doing 1/2 teaspoon of salt. And then I did 1/4 cup of honey. So I'm mixing my dry ingredients separate in this larger bowl from my wet ingredients. And I want my wet ingredients with my honey, my 2 eggs, and my 8 tablespoons of melted butter. I do mix those and get those nice and creamy and whipped up before I add them to my bigger bowl with my dry ingredients. So then it is a cup of carrots and a cup of apples shredded. I mean, this is more than a cup, but it's okay. A cup-ish, I guess. So it's okay if you get a little bit more than a cup, or you don't tend to measure it out like I did. So I basically did 1 apple and 1 carrot and called it good. So here is where I'm adding my butter. I got it out the oven from melting, so it is pretty warm, but it's not too hot. The bowl is hot, so it's hotter than the butter, so that's why I was holding it like that. But here I'm just gently mixing it, and I'm gonna get that the honey and everything, all of the wet ingredients, nice and creamed together. It doesn't go white because there's nothing white in the mixture, to make it white and fluffy. But it does get creamed up, it does get smooth, it does get a little fluffy. And so that's what I'm looking for before I add it, if you can see there, before I add it to the dry ingredients. So when I'm mixing these cookies together, since I have all-purpose flour, I am not wanting to activate the gluten because I don't want my cookies bready. So to help not activate that gluten, I am going to mix these carefully and gently. But I'm not going to mix them since I still have the carrots and the apples to mix in there too. I'm not going to mix this all the way to where everything is completely coated. See, I have dry pockets there, a lot of dry flour, and now I'm adding the carrots and the apples, and now I'm going to fold everything back in. And so since I still had some mixing to do with the carrots and apples while I'm doing that, it's working the rest of that flour in. So everything's going to have plenty of time to be incorporated and not be overmixed. Because when you overmix your cookies, that's when they become bready because you activated your gluten. If you're doing it gluten-free, you don't really have anything like that to worry about. So I form these in a ball and I put them on my stone here. And then I just flattened the tops with a spoon. These cookies don't really rise, they stay the shape that you're going to form them. So I just flattened them a little bit with a spoon and I baked them at 350 degrees Fahrenheit for about 13 minutes. And so here I'm taking them off of my stone. I'm going to put them on a cooling rack, and you can see they're not rising, they're not expanding. It's not that kind of cookie. So with these cookies, they did taste a little more like biscuits. They were lacking quite a bit of flavor that I was expecting anyways. I was thinking more of like a carrot cake type cookie because it had carrots and apples in it. They were still good. It was more like a biscuit, which is a little bit of sweetness. And everybody enjoyed eating those, dipping them in some honey. That's how they ate them. But if I was going to remake them because I'm wanting more flavor to it, I would probably add a little bit more honey and definitely some more spices. I would add some vanilla, I would add some nutmeg, maybe a little cinnamon because I didn't really taste the cinnamon that much. And I think adding just a few of those is going to help. But these were really good to eat as biscuits, dipping them in some honey. So here my bread is ready. I am greasing my cast iron pans here. I love these things for bread. And I'm using coconut oil. You of course can use whatever you like, any kind of fat that you would like. This is my dough. It is still moist, it's still soft, but it's not super sticky. This is the perfect dough. So I have some of it stuck to the bowl a little bit, so I'm trying to get as much as I can out, not leave any of that precious dough behind. But yeah, when you're trying to gauge on if your dough is ready, if it's really going to work out or not for you, you want it silky, you want it smooth. It's okay if it's kind of soft, is slightly sticky, slightly moist, but you don't want it too sticky or moist, and you definitely want it to be able to stretch because that stretch means that the gluten's nice and ready. So I'm forming it in my little logs here, and making sure there's the pretty top is on top of it, and then the ugly part is on the bottom, folding everything to one side, kind of do a little shimmy with it to stretch it the length of the pan, and I'm going to stick it on top of my stove here to go ahead and rise again while the oven is preheating. So the oven was preheating to 350 again, and I let it cover. It probably sat there about maybe 15-20 minutes to rise a little bit more and just rest. And so I bake it at 350 degrees Fahrenheit for 30 minutes. And then when it is ready, I take it out and I'm going to dump it out on top of my cooling rack. And I don't want to leave it in the pans. I want it to be on the cooling rack to cool. So here, I left this in here because I wanted y'all to see. Sometimes even greasing your pans, it can stick a little bit. So you don't need to freak out and you don't want to leave it in there. All you do is you get a knife And you just go along the edges, all four edges of your bread. So you keep the knife as close to the pan as you can. Don't really let it cut into the bread. But you just want to loosen the sides of the bread from that pan a little bit. Doesn't take much. And then you'll be able to dump it out. My little grips here have a hole, and so it was hard for me to figure out how to get a good angle with them without burning my fingers. But see, that bread came right out after I just loosened the side. So you do want to make sure you for sure grease the very bottom real good, because if it gets stuck on the bottom, that can be a little trickier. But I didn't have quite enough of the coconut oil on the sides, and that's okay. All you have to do, see, we're going to do it again with this one. This one's stuck too. And so all we're going to do, yeah, see, it's stuck a little bit. So all we're going to do is we just get the knife and you just go along the side of the pan just real gently. And if you need to, you can go up and down. If it's not gliding real smooth, just kind of go up and down, loosen it a little bit. Sometimes if they're going over the pan too, that it'll stick to that top part. Even though I do put coconut oil there too, it can still stick. So just loosen it on the sides, flip it over, and you shouldn't have a problem with it coming right out. So when that happens, there's nothing to worry about. It's gonna be fine. Just loosen on the side, and just a little troubleshooting thing there.